Welcome back to the channel, everybody. What you're about to see here is nothing short of AI ambush. What the F? You know, I couldn't have made that happen if I'd tried when I was recording, so that was gold. Hello, guys. Today we are going to showcase the 4 Degree of Freedom Motion Simulator platform with two different tracks and two different cars so that we can show how dynamically the motion simulator changes with power to weight ratios in cars. And this highlights the accuracy of sim tools as far as its data transfer goes. And that's a great thing. So we'll be racing today in the R380 Nissan Mark II around Cadwell Park and Spa. Just a couple of laps of each track. We'll be doing it in this car, and then we'll be swapping over and doing exactly the same tracks in this bad boy, in the GT40 Mark IV. Now, you've got double the horsepower in this car to the Nissan. You've got over 500 horsepower and almost double the weight. The Nissan's got about 220 horsepower. It's about 600 kilos. You'll see how dynamically that changes, particularly the surge in the motion sim, because of the way that sim tools emulates those actual differences in weights and power and transfers that data to your actual motion sim. It's fantastic. Sim Tools is a really, really good program. Okay, you've got to tweak it and get things working, but it's a fantastic program once you get tweaking and stuff sorted. And we'll be going through all of this in the later tutorials. So let me enlighten you guys on some of the inherent design features of the Doctor ADHD 4 Degree of Freedom Motion Sim platform that I haven't spoken about previously, and that is the way I've designed my sim with the materials I've designed it to amplify what's actually happening with the forces from the motors, okay? Now, this sim was a sim that I thought about for a long time before I started to build it, and the materials I've chosen for this particular simulator for strength, but also for flex, okay? So the simulator utilizes natural flex in the metals that I've used to amplify the forces generated by the motors, negating the need for extra motors, and it works really, really well. Now, this is particularly prominent now that I've been able to actually bring in some heave into the surge motor. That's right, I've blended heave in with the surge, and this is working really, really well. It's taking me a while to tweak this, and again, guys, I will share this, but because we have our spring heave modification, so our high compression springs under our seat, this has emulated rear suspension in a car to complement the way I designed this particular motion sim, and I've designed this a little bit like a small car, so then the motors are at the very front, so they emulate the front suspension of a car, and that's why it works so well. So with a combination of the actual length of the sim, which is deliberately built as long as it's built, so guys, you could build this shorter, but you're going to miss out on the flex that's brought in by the length of this sim and by the materials chosen to build this out of. You're going to miss out on those dynamics in the sim being amplified by the actual motors themselves, if you chose to build it shorter than what the spec actually is. Because that spec is actually designed to work in harmony with our seat spring heave modification with those high compression springs. Those two things are a match made in heaven. They work very well together, and so it's definitely advantageous to keep the sim to the lengths that it's been built at for that particular purpose. And a great example of that is what I was talking about earlier with the new addition of the heave axis placed on the surge motor and blended with the surge. This brings through things very clearly, like contact with other cars, hitting high curbs, rumble strips, etc. Because it comes from the front motors partially, and it comes right back into your body. Check this out, guys. I nearly roll the car here, and look what happens with the sim. Fantastic roll and traction loss at the same time. Now, for you guys out there who are building the sim, or you know, building your own version around my design, I hope it's going well for you. Anytime, you can hit me up in the comments if you're having issues, if you're having problems, if you need some advice, if you need some enlightenment on something, I'm pretty easy, pretty approachable. I always do my best to try and get back to everybody in the comments. Things are not too crazy on my channel at the moment, so it's not like I've got, you know, 1,000 questions all the time coming at me. So keep that in mind, guys. I'm here to help you on your journey to get your sim built. So don't be shy. No question is a silly question. We've all been there, and I've asked a million questions of different people, like over at xsimulator.net, about stuff, and I've got help along the way to do this, guys, and that's what it's all about. It's about helping each other out. So if you've got questions, don't hesitate to ask. Okay, guys, let's have a look at the GT40 Mark IV. Now, what you'll really notice here is the sheer amount of surge, particularly in between gear changes. Keep an eye on that, guys, as well as the D-cell and the XL. Check out the surge and the fishtailing there. Really, really picks that up brilliantly. Because we're in double the weight car now, you'll really see the braking, particularly in the hat cam camera. You'll see how much we surge forward on that trolley rail system. It really is a handful, this car. Again, an overpowered car for this type of course, really, but it's a lot of fun. Now, you can literally feel yourself being pushed forward when you're trying to break into those corners, just like a car would push you forward because of the weight of the car. That's transferring into the sim with the trolley rail system brilliantly. Really happy with that. See, look at the surge there on the braking. Oh yeah, a bit of contact there, and a bit of contact there. Those little hits, guys, they come straight into your seat from the surge motor, because the surge motor is directly under our seat, attached to the uni joint, which sits just in front of our seat. That's what balances our rig very nicely. But that comes straight into your seat when you have contact with other cars. It's fantastic. Look at me being pushed forward here. The inertia. It really simulates it so well, to the point where I think it's almost time for an airbag in the steering wheel so we don't face plant into the steering wheel. Be good to stay on the track there, Doc. Oh, look at that, guys. Some great traction loss there. Great example of that. So, for this demonstration, in Game Manager in SimTools, I've actually got the intensity slider all the way to 100. I've done that because when it's at 100, it brings all the forces to bear from all of your axis assignments, from all the degrees of force, onto the sim. So I've really sort of done that for demonstration purposes for this video. But for long sessions in the sim, I'd dial that down by 20%. I'd add 20% smoothing, and I'd have that because that's what the Game Manager intensity bar does. It smooths all of your axes, and I'd add 20% smoothing if I was going to be playing for, you know, more than an hour, and I'd run things on about 80. And we'll talk about that in the later tutorials. Now, here we are at Spa 1966 by the Reboot team. They've done a fantastic job with the road telemetry, with the road meshing here. This was a very bad track for missing bits of tarmac, etc., for so many years, and you'll see how bumpy this is and how well that translates into the sim. It really literally rattles your teeth out. So if you've got false teeth, best if you be putting those in the glass before you start driving. Because they're going to fall out, guys, on the floor. Us old people, it's just pathetic. Running the AI in this particular session between 95% and 98.5%, and I'm running their aggression up at 75%, and that just gives the AI skill set a good range between 95 and 98. And I've got their aggression set up at 75%, so that just makes them quite a handful at times. It makes them quite aggressive, but it makes them really fun to race against. You get quite a bit of contact. There's a downside to that, I guess, in a Seto Corsa, because they do get quite aggressive over 70%. Just means on some tracks you can tend to get pushed off the road quite a bit. But anyway, that's just something that you've got to learn to manage and to deal with. You'll notice when you get on the edges, see that, guys? When you get onto the edges, that wasn't a great example actually, but when you get on some of the edges of this track, it really throws the motion sim around a lot. To me, I think that's quite realistic. I think that equals a very good road meshing. The reboot team have done a great job. There you go, see that? If you rewind the video there, guys, have a look at the force feedback steering wheel at the same time as the rig. You'll see the two are in harmony. So, guys, I use a Fenatec CSL direct drive wheel. It's the 8 newton meter version. And so it is a very good force feedback steering wheel. So you can indeed get that tweaked, and you can use that as a reference to getting your motion sim tweaked. Two really should be in harmony together. What you're feeling through your force feedback steering wheel, you should be getting in your motion simulator rig. And of course, all of this stuff, guys, comes down to personal taste. Yeah, it's very rough through that bit. I probably should have been watching the corner here and not this car. I almost took out the corner here. Okay, let's have a look at the GT40 now on the same track. The heave is particularly amplified in this car because of its weight on this particular track. You get rocked around and bounced around a lot more than the little Nissan. And of course, the back end of the car is a lot harder to keep straight. What I love is the accuracy of the traction loss. So that big sweeping bend back there, for example, guys. The car starts to go out a little bit. The sim starts to go out a little bit. As soon as I accelerate to drive out of the traction loss, the sim straightens up like the car straightens up. And I couldn't be happier with the traction loss, but it's taken hours of tweaking, of fiddling around with filters, degrees of force, and I'll get into that later, guys, and I'll show you some of the stuff that I've set up for that. A near miss here. Now we're coming up to a particularly rough part of this course. This section through here is really, really rough. The tarmac, chunks of tarmac missing, and it's reflected straight into the motion sim platform. It's just great. Ouch. Look at the pushing there when I brake. The surge between gear changes is phenomenal. Now, being the owner, guys, of a muscle car myself, of a big 393 cubic inch muscle car with all the fruit, it goes pretty hard, my muscle car. I can tell you these sort of forces are what you experience in a car like this. My muscle car is around that 600 horsepower, almost 500 foot-pounds of torque, and it feels pretty similar, guys, in a lot of ways. It's quite remarkable. I guess that's the advantage of having someone like myself who's designed the sim the way I've designed it, because, you know, I've got real world experience with similar power cars, similar weights, similar power. It's helped me. It's helped me come up with a way to design this simulator that's realistic. Hey, thanks so much, everybody, for tuning in. Thanks for watching. I hope this has been some inspiration to you if you're building the sim and you're hanging out to sort of get up to this stage. Just keep at it, guys. You will get there. For any newbies to the channel, thanks for tuning in. I hope you've enjoyed what you've seen. The Doctor always appreciates a subscription, so thanks for subscribing. I appreciate that. Well, until I see you in the next video, guys, you guys stay safe, stay healthy, and take it easy out there.